interact with you on one of the important aspects, that is events of instruction. My first question, pehle nahi keh rahi si baat, my first question to the audience is, why we teach? Let me get the response from the audience. Why we teach? Yes. Yes. Any member would like to respond to this question?
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon. Abrar this side from IMS Engineering College. Are you you are audible? Sorry, my voice is audible to you.
Yes, sir. It is audible.
We are teaching because of we want to transfer our
just a minute, your voice is echoing. Okay, ji, now please continue. Mr. Brad,
yes,
you can continue,
yes.
Sir.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. Actually, with the help of teaching or with the help of teaching methodology, we have to transfer our knowledge from one generation to another generation.
Okay. Okay, thank you so much. Any other member who would like to respond to why we teach?
Hello, ma'am. This is Anurag from IMS Engineering College.
Hanji.
I would like to say that by teaching through, we can actually disseminate our expertise to the students, or we share our knowledge to the among the others.
Okay. Can I request Dronacharya or Shahid Udham Singh any responses for this question? Any other response which you would like to give?
Hello, ma'am.
Anji.
We want to teach because we want to make the things simpler for the students. We want to help them in the learning process.
Okay.
And at the same time, we also learn a lot of things.
Thank you so much. May I know your name?
This is Preeti.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. So, friends, I was looking for a cue from your side. When we say, why do we teach, the basic purpose of teaching is to facilitate learning among the students. That means teaching is intimately related to learning, and unless and until there is learning, we can say that no teaching has taken place. So teaching and learning go hand in hand. The two prior answers which I got, transfer knowledge from one generation to another, that is the basic purpose of education. But nowadays, when we talk in terms of teaching, it is not simply transferring the knowledge, but the student is at the center of teaching learning process, and thus he is the person or she is the person who has to learn. So the role of the teacher is to simply create conditions whereby we can facilitate learning among the student. So when we talk in terms of learning, learning can be variously classified, and in the previous session, Dr. Punia also has been referring to three domains. He has been referring to cognitive, psychomotor, affective domain. In other words, in simpler words, we say that when somebody is teaching, the learning can be in terms of knowledge, learning can be the acquisition of skills, that is psychomotor domain, knowledge domain is referred to cognitive domain, and there can be third type of learning which is referred to as affective domain, which is concerned with attitude, behavior, values, etc. Guiney and Driscoll, they have tried to classify learning into five categories. You can see here, one category is the verbal information. What do we mean by verbal information? Any discipline which you are teaching in the engineering college has lot of factual information and labels. When I say there is factual information, there are labels. So when somebody says that there are two types of soil foundation, and you talk in terms of deep and shallow foundation. When you talk in terms of there are three types of computer memory, primary memory, secondary memory, and cache memory, this is nothing but factual information in the subject. If I say there are about 20 teachers sitting and attending the program at SUS, maybe this is a factual information. Or I say the color of the chair in the hall is red, and this is also a factual information. So lot of factual information forms a part of your discipline which you are teaching, and then in addition to that you have labels, the names of the objects, the names of the instruments, the names of the machines, and the names of the tools, they all come as labels. Now somebody telling the name, say this is vernier caliper. So vernier caliper is the label given to a particular device. When we say this is meter, now this is also a name given to a device. Then you talk about oscilloscope. Even I say, when we say this is a computer, computer is a name given to a device. So this is nothing but label. And wherever you have machinery, tools, they are given certain names, they are referred to as labels. So combined together, the organized body of knowledge is referred to as the verbal information. So whenever you are teaching, one type of learning, the varieties of learning, is the verbal information which a student acquires. The second is the intellectual skills. When I say intellectual skills, that means they have to do something with the processing of information. And here you can see, when we talk in terms of processing of information, the lowest level of learning in any area is the discrimination. Discrimination may be between two alphabets. Discrimination may be between two objects. Discrimination may be between two concepts, and so on. So discrimination is the basic level of learning as far as intellectual skills are concerned. Then comes the concept learning. When I say concept, concepts are category names. Now there are so many things around you, and you have tried to classify the whole universe into certain categories. Whenever you say human being and animals, even these are category. Human being is a label you have given to one category. Animal kingdom is another name you have given to other kind of species which are available, which have certain common essential attributes. Now whenever you say concept, concept is a category name which has certain essential attributes. Now if you can see, I am showing here, you can see I'm just showing you a chair. This particular chair, when I'm referred to chair, has certain essential attributes. Anybody who can say what are the essential attributes of a chair? Can I get a response? I say chair is a concept. Chair has certain essential attributes. Anyone who will let me know what are the essential attributes of a chair? Yes? Any response from the audience? Let it be interactive. Hanji?
This is Anurag.
Right.
From IMS. Ma'am, chair should have four pillars, and base over those four pillars, and we should have a base at which we can rest our back.
Okay. Thank you so much. Anuragji, you are right that chair is an object which requires support from beneath. Seat to sit, there is support for the back. It may have four pillars or it may have one pillar is immaterial. So legs, the number of legs is not important, but it should have support. So you can see the essential attributes are only three. The support from beneath, a chair to the seat to sit, and a support from beneath. Now what is non-essential here is the material. It may be plastic, it may be iron, it may be wood, or you can have color of the chair which is immaterial, which is not essential attribute. It may be red, it may be blue, it may be beige, it may be white, and so on. Or the chair may be stationary, the static one, or maybe a rotating one. So you can have different types of chairs, and you may have chair without armrest or with armrest. So the three essential attributes. So in a particular discipline, you come across number of concepts. Now, when I talk in terms of mechanical engineering or electrical, you take an example of, say, civil engineering. There are number of concepts. When you talk of flow, is a concept. When you talk of a wall, is a concept. When you talk of a beam, it is a concept. When you talk of columns, it is a concept. You talk of reinforcement, it is a concept. When you talk in terms of permeability, it is a concept. When you talk in terms of stress, it is a concept. You talk in terms of shear force, it is a concept. But all these concepts can be further subdivided into two. There are certain concepts which can be pointed out, which can be shown. There are other concepts which need to be defined. Now here, when I'm using the concept, say flow, I can point out to a flow. I can show it. There is a tangible referent to flow. When I say wall, I can show it. When I say roof, I can show it. Beam, I can show. Column, I can show. But think of when I say force, I can't show it. When you say shear force, I can't show it. I need to define it. When I talk in terms of reinforcement, I need to define it. So there is learning of two types. One are the defined concepts which a person acquires the knowledge of. There are concrete concepts which can be referred to. Then comes the rule. A person learns number of principles or rules in a particular discipline. When you talk about rules, rule is nothing but is relationship between two or more than two concepts. When you say stress is directly proportional to strain, or you say voltage is directly proportional to current. Now, voltage is a concept, current is a concept, proportional is a concept, stress is a concept, proportional is a concept, strain is a concept. So what a rule is? Rule is indicating relationship between two or more than two concepts. So as a person who is acquiring knowledge in a particular discipline, acquires knowledge related to variety of rules in that particular discipline. Then comes problem solving. This is the highest level of ability one acquires through learning, and this involves component abilities of ability to analyze, ability to evaluate, ability to create. Because when you solve a problem, the outcome may be designing of a new technique, designing of a new structure, designing of a new product, or it may require an innovative original solution to a problem being faced in a real life or a day-to-day life or in the world of work. So problem solving ability is also a learned ability which is the outcome of any teaching learning process. Then you have, as a student, a person acquires motor skills. And when I say motor skills, initially they were designated as motor skills. But nowadays, rather than using the word motor skill, one uses the word psychomotor skills. And why motor? Because this was referring to muscular coordination. Psychomotor refers to, it involves cognitive as well as the muscular coordination. And every skill learning has integral part of cognition. That means having a prior knowledge of the object or the machine or the product would enable you to operate it more efficiently. I can learn operating a lathe machine if I have the knowledge of what are the various parts of the lathe machine, what are the functions of the various parts of lathe machine, what are the processes which can be performed on the lathe machine. So cognition is an integral part of the psychomotor learning. So a student who is taken to labs, who are taken to the workshops, who are given project work, the ultimate outcome is they acquire psychomotor skills. Whether you are verifying a law in the laboratory, even then you are manipulating with machinery, equipment and tools. So you are trying to acquire psychomotor skills of handling the machinery, machines, tools, instruments which are available in the laboratories and the workshops. So any work which is carried out in the labs, in the workshop, during the project work, or when you send your students to the industry for industrial training, the outcome of that is, in addition to getting some knowledge, they are getting psychomotor skills because they are involved in learning by doing. Then comes attitudes. And I think Dr. M.S. Garewal has put a lot of focus on this aspect, that whenever a student undergoes a training program or education and training program, the outcomes are not limited to the knowledge and skills, but there are changes which take place in the student with respect to his attitude, behaviors. And that is the most important component. And Dr. Punia also laid emphasis on that, that the industry is looking for the people who possess favorable attitude towards working in with hands, or they have learning to learn skills. So they are very positive about learning to learn. They are willing to learn. They are, so when there is willingness, the attitude is favorable. So the person who has favorable attitude, that is preferred over the others who do not possess favorable attitude. So attitudes are developed when we are teaching students in classrooms, laboratories, workshops, or we are interacting with our students outside the classroom, outside the labs, outside the workshop. So the teacher as such is a human model who tries to bring certain attitudinal and behavioral changes among the students when they are being taught in classrooms, labs, or they are outside and interacting with them. Or in addition to that, when you organize number of co-curricular activities, your aim is to develop the attitudes and behavior which are desirable among your students. And the last variety of learning which is there is referred to as cognitive strategies. When I say cognitive strategies, again, these are the ways and means which are adopted by a person to locate information, to pay attention to retain information, to recall information, and to apply that information when it is needed. So whatever ways and means you adopt to learn something, to think about something, to apply the knowledge in a given context, those ways and methods are referred to as cognitive strategies. Just let me give one example. When we are taking notes in the classroom, one person take word by word note. whatever is spoken, that is being written. That is the strategy a person adopts to remember the information. There is another individual sitting in the same classroom who tries to jot down the notes in his own words. He doesn't go by word noting, but he tries to prepare a brief gist of what the teacher has said. He tries to write in his own words. That is the strategy adopted by another person. Now, this is one way how you try to remember the information, and then you are able to recall it. Again, there are different strategies which are adopted by the individual. A person comes to you with a problem. You say, leave the problem and I'll let you know tomorrow. Another person is there, maybe Deepika is there. She says, leave the problem. No, don't leave the problem. You sit with me. I just let you know how to solve the problem. Now, this lady is able to recall the information which has been stored in her mind, and the other person is able, not able to recall the information. He requires to either review the information, or the person would like to ponder upon and then come out with a solution. So different ways and methods. Some people are easily able to recall the information which is there in the cognitive repertoire. So different ways and methods of storing the information and then recalling the information. Many people are able to remember the names of the people who they met, who they meet for a long period of time. Even after 10 years, you are able to recall the name of the person and call the person by his name. There are many others who will not be able to even identify the person and what to talk about, recalling the name of the person. So this is the different ways and means used by the people to store the information, that is, remember the information, then the different ways and means of recalling the information and then applying in a given situation. So the outcomes of learning can be broadly classified as per Guiney and Briggs into five, that is, cognitive in the verbal information, then intellectual skills comprising of discrimination, concept learning, rule learning, problem solving. Then you have the motor skills, which are now referred to as psychomotor skills. Then you have attitudes, and then you have the cognitive strategies. These are the five major varieties of learning. If these are five major varieties of learning, the way we teach, the kind of conditions those are required to enable the person to acquire these five types of learning would vary. Now think of, I have to simply remember the names of the objects. Now if I go on repeating the name of the object 10 times, or write the name of the object 10 times, the name of the object goes into my long-term memory. So it is a rote memorization which requires repeated recall naming of that object, maybe either in writing or in orally. But look, if I have to remember a rule and I need to know how to apply that rule, I don't need the simple statement of rule, because statement of rule is again rote memorization. But if the rule learning is evident when a student is able to apply that rule in a given situation. So if I have to apply the rule, that means lot of practice is needed. So practice comes into play. If I need to acquire motor skills, I need to know how to operate late. Then I need to have a lot of practice on late machine. Only then proficiency would come in or would creep in. If I want to bring a change in the attitude, then if you simply tell me how to do it, it doesn't matter. Attitude is, if I want to, I need to break down the older practice, the older or undesirable behavior on the part of the student. Then I have to freeze. Means You have to first unfreeze, then freeze. That means you need to first break down the wrong behavior, then provide adequate practice to the person of the desired behavior. Then the person will be able to acquire the right kind of behavior. So different conditions are required for learning of these different types of learning. So in this session, I am going to speak on what are when you are involved in direct instruction, say lecture method, you can enhance the effectiveness of this direct instruction by following nine events of instruction. When I say nine events of instruction, these events of instructions can be classified into nine, which include
unke paas ja nahi raha
freeze inne chal raha bahut
chal raha utte nahi ja raha na.
Now again, when we get
net bar bar ja
raha utte hi dikha de, main udhar hi bolta hu.
वो तो है नहीं आपके
डायरेक्ट उधर से चल रहा है.
आई एम सॉरी, जस्ट गिव मी वन मिनट. Attention of the learner. Second important event of instruction is that you have to arouse the necessary motivation on the part of the learner to learn a particular topic, and that arousal of motivation starts with when you tell the student what he or she will be able to do at the end of instruction. So what I am not able to do at present, if I'll be able to do it after I have taken the instructions or I have learned the topic, then I am motivated to learn that topic. Say for example, I am not able to solve higher level differential equation and the teacher tells me, gives me a problem and says solve. I say I am not able to solve because I don't know how to solve this higher order differential equation. And the teacher tells me, today I'm going to teach you how to solve this problem, which is higher order differential equation. And I'm there to learn because I'm unable to do certain tasks. Without learning, I cannot proceed. So informing learners of objectives is the second event which is important. Then any student who comes to our class comes with certain previous set of knowledge, skills and attitudes. A student cannot be treated as an empty vessel. The student has experience of 16 years, 17 years, and then he's coming to the class. the experience the student brings to the class may be right, may be appropriate, may be inappropriate. He may have certain right conceptions, he may have certain misconceptions. So the task of the teacher is to recall what a student is knowing already. He should be enabled to recall that, and if there is any kind of misconception, that misconception need to be removed by the teacher to provide further input. So whatever previous knowledge which is relevant to the topic need to be brought to the working memory of the student, and that is what is the event which is stimulating recall of previous knowledge. The fourth event of instruction is, once you are sure that whatever was the previous knowledge the student is able to bring to the working memory, then the task of the teacher is to present the new information. Here you find the word stimuli. Stimulus is nothing but anything which activates. Now people take a cup of tea because they are feeling lazy. They are not interested in carrying out with the activity. So they require some kind of activation. They have a cup of tea. There is another individual who smokes. So tea and cigarette, they act as stimulus to activate the individual to think or indulge in an activity. Likewise, whatever a teacher does in the classroom, whether he's using the words, he's showing a diagram, he's showing a video clip, all these act like a stimuli to activate the student thinking. So after recall comes the presentation of new information. Then while you are presenting information, it is not enough. You need to facilitate the process of remembering that information. So that is what is referred here, providing learning guidance. I am very sure till date you remember WebGear, you remember WordMass. Now this you have learned when you were in a school. You remember the seven colors of the rainbow by the just one small acronym, that is WebGear, and you can recall the name of the seven colors. WordMass give you the rules of opening up the brackets and so on. So here when you are doing algebraic sum, you are remembering WordMass and you are applying those rules in a given situation. When you are giving examples, you are giving similes, they are all to facilitate learning on the part of the learner. So that is what is referred to as providing learning guidance. Then the task of the teacher is not only to present information and provide learning guidance. The task of the teacher is, while you are proceeding with your lecture session, you also need to evaluate, make sure that students are understanding whatever you are teaching. This is where you are simply eliciting the response on the part of the learner, but you are not evaluating. You are trying to monitor whether the students are able to comprehend, students are able to understand, are they able to keep pace with you. That is what is referred to as eliciting performance. Then the next important event is providing feedback. Providing feedback means giving the knowledge of results. If you are eliciting performance, then you should also be able to judge whether that is right or wrong and what is the corrective feedback which is required to improve upon the performance of the individual. That is what providing feedback is. And the eighth event of instruction is assessing performance. Assessing, once the student has learned, then learning process doesn't end if the person has learned. We expect the student to apply that knowledge in a novel situation, transfer the learned things to real life situation and to the world of work. And that is what the last event of instruction is, that is enhancing transfer of learning to new situations. So now we'll deal with these nine events of instruction one by one. When I say gaining attention, let me pose this question to the audience. If you are ensuring that your students pay attention to what you are teaching, what are some of the strategies which you adopt? Yes? The strategies you adopt to gain attention of your students to what you are teaching. Over to IMS. So maybe let me start with IMS first. Anybody who would like to respond to the question? Aap sab teachers ho, aap sab padhate ho. Aap apne students ki attention gain karne ke liye kya karte hain?
This is Dr. Pankaj from IMS.
Okay.
So what actually I'll share what we actually do. Like one of the useful means and useful ways is use of real world examples is something which really which a student looks forward. Okay. So if you're able to relate what you're teaching with some real world example, fine, that always helps students.
Fine. Thank you very much. Any other answer from the IMS or may I? Hanji.
Hello, ma'am. This is Anurag Mishra.
Anurag ji. Hanji.
Ma'am, actually, every time students are very pretty much curious about how they are going to be in a career after passing out. So if we relate our teaching or our course curriculum, like this would be helpful in their interviews or this would be helpful in their CAT exam, GATE exam. So they are pretty much interested in their teaching.
Okay. Thank you very much, Anurag ji. Any other? May I go to now Shaheed Uddam Singh? Okay, ma'am, please.
I'm Richa Mishra from IMS. I think students are more interested in latest technology and what are the current trends that are applicable in industry. So we can get more and more interest from that.
Okay. Thank you. Actually, my question is not to generate interest, but to gain attention. Just pay attention to that word, attention. How you gain attention of your students towards what you are going to teach. That is the question. Over
good
to
morning.
You. Hanji, good morning.
I'm Umesh Gupta. Ma'am, basically, when we are teaching, so suppose some of the students are not focusing on the lectures, what we are delivering. Hanji. So that time, we have to create some environment, we have to take some examples. So in that example, we can involve those students and create some mimic and your story so that will relate to the our concept. So okay. That is the basic way to attract the student or to attend those students, they can attend to us and they can easily understand what we are delivering.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your responses. Let me now give you Achha, chalo. Now you can have a, when we talk in terms of gaining attention, now here see a slide. What are you looking at? What is the word which draws your attention here?
IC.
IC engine. Kyun aapki ye IC engine pe nazar ja rahi hai, baakiyon pe nahin gayi hai?
Bold hai, bada hai.
Bold hai, bada hai. Next, let's go to. But ye to mushkil hai, agge main kitna chalangi? Now here, can you see another slide?
Yes, here is program.
Okay, so why the color is different?
Yes.
What is the difference here?
No difference.
No difference. Just have a look, sir. See here. Kya hua hai? The movement. The movement. Ek to seedha appear ho gaya, ek niche se aapko movement show kar raha hai. Now here, I'm showing you number of references. You might have seen network, learners TV, learners. Now what I want to say is, once I go to the class and my students are just managing to manage their seats, manage their things, what I do? You start with a wish. You say, good morning everyone. Now this is a verbal clue which you are sending to your students. If they are settling down while listening to the voice of the teacher, they start paying attention to the teacher. One, I enter the classroom, I stand silently for a fraction of a second. I don't even speak. Automatically, the students feel, oh, the teacher has entered the class, but she has not started gain attention. The very first thing, I gain attention. You are going to start a topic. You are starting the topic with a very complex problem which they are unable to solve. The students pay attention to you, how to come to the solution to that problem. My friend rightly said that you are going into the class, you start with narrating a particular story which brings them to the topic which is at hand. So you start with a story. Story itself would gain attention and then they'll remain attentive. But you have to use other strategies to sustain their attention. You may start your topic with a quote. The quote, which is very powerful, said by a person who is well respected, well recognized, and that words, they carry weight. So you start with a quote by Mahatma Gandhi, you start with a quote by Abraham Lincoln, or you start a give a quote by Narendra Modi nowadays, or this any person who is an authority in that particular field, if you give a quote by that person, the people pay attention to that. Now here, what I exactly wanted to show you, there is a site called Learners TV, and you will find there are many animations here available. When you click the animation, and you here would like to go to the physics animation, and here there are a number of physics options which are available. You click any electric, magnetic, evla kar lo, koi bhi kar lo. Simple buzzer kar do. Okay. Now here, here you can see here, and there is a button which has to be pressed. So current, you have pressed this. Click on the switch to close. Now you see, now this particular whole buzzer, simple buzzer, and there is animated figure. And if you take this animated figure, one thing is I draw a diagram on the board and I start explaining, but I can't simulate. Now you have the tool where you can have animation and simulation. Animation and simulation, when used in the class, even that helps you to gain attention. So there are, I'm not going to show you all these, but I would like to go to the NAPTIL. You can go to the NAPTIL and see. So when you go to the NAPTIL and you open up a particular program, you see that the logo of IIT that appears. When you see the logo, it is not stationary. Ek program nu click kar do NAPTIL te. When you see the program, the logo appears, there is a movement, there is a sound effect which is given to the title, and the title appears on the screen. Now when you bring in some variation in the sound, you have certain effects on how the text is appearing, the people automatically pay attention to it. If something stationary is being shown again and again, maybe at one particular point of time, you lose interest in that. Now here, you show any one program, discrete mathematics. Say there is one program which I am clicking as discrete mathematics. What I have said, Alan Dolan, Anji. So that means, now here you see, the logo is appearing, the words are emerging, the Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee. Whenever there is sound effect given to it, it will further draw the attention of your learner. So some kind of animation, audio effect, movement effect, when you bring in to the classroom presentations, they will certainly draw the attention of your students. Go back, go back, go back. Just it was an example to them. Now this you might have been using in your classes, so a video clip can also help you start your lecture. So a video clip showing a complex problem, then coming to what exactly should be done with. So you can use different strategies for gaining attention. And I have, say, you can use a demonstration also. Now when I say you can use the demonstration also, it will not work here. But there are small demonstrations which are available on YouTube. I've just, because there is no second file to add, dancing cans, falling eggs. Falling eggs show you the kinetic energy concept being made to the clear to the students. And when we are talking about the dancing canes, then it is with respect to the center of gravity. When the center of gravity changes, the can start dancing. Otherwise, the can filled by the water doesn't dance. So you can think of many novel things which can be used. Agli chalna unhe, eh to tere te dependent hogi main. Nahi. So you can see here, so when you are looking at the different ways of gaining attention, so here we have dealt with story, you can start with a problem, you can start with a new situation, you can give a demonstration, you can use multimedia presentation, and here you can start with animation. If I have used here the electric and magnetic fields oscillating, again that goes to learner's TV, and you can see, you can show the electric and magnetic fields generated by an electric charge. So once you are utilizing this kind of media, then it is very easy for the students to pay attention to. Another, you can see here a simple concept of dropping two balls near the earth surface. Itte click ho gaya, itte chal rahe hain, to unko kholenge to chalega har bari hai, tab ek minute chhodo. So friends, when we ਇਹ ਨਾ ਕਰ, ਮੈਨੂੰ ਹੁਣ ਉਹ ਸਭ ਨੂੰ ਡਿਸਟਰਬੈਂਸ ਤਾਂ ਹੁੰਦੀ ਹੈ ਨਾ. ਜਸਟ ਸ਼ੋ ਇਹਨੂੰ ਕਲਿੱਕ ਕਰ. ਕਿੱਥੇ ਵੀ ਇਹ ਟੈਕਨੋਲੋਜੀ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮਸ ਹੈ. ਹੋ ਗਿਆ ਹੁਣ ਬਈ, ਦਿਸ ਇਜ਼ ਨਾਟ ਡਨ. ਕਿੱਥੇ ਹੁਣ ਤੂੰ ਪਹੁੰਚ ਗਈ? ਅੰਦਰ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈ. ਸੋ ਫਰੈਂਡਸ, ਹੇਅਰ ਯੂ ਕੈਨ ਸੀ ਦੈਟ ਆਈ ਹੈਵ ਸ਼ੋਨ ਯੂ ਵਨ ਅਨਦਰ. ਯੂ ਕੈਨ ਸੀ, ਹੁਣ ਉੱਥੇ ਨਹੀਂ ਚੱਲੇਗਾ, ਕਹਾਂ ਚੱਲ ਰਿਹਾ, ਉਹ ਤਾਂ ਚੱਲ ਨਹੀਂ ਰਿਹਾ. ਆਪ ਉਸਕੋ ਕਲਿੱਕ ਕਰੋ, ਇਸਕੋ ਕਲਿੱਕ ਕਰੋ, ਕਲਿੱਕ ਟੂ ਵਿਊ ਐਨੀਮੇਸ਼ਨ. ਨੋ, ਆਈ ਜਸਟ ਵਾਂਟਡ ਟੂ ਬ੍ਰਿੰਗ ਟੂ ਯੋਰ ਨੋਟਿਸ ਦੈਟ ਹੇਅਰ dropping two balls near the earth surface, and you are just showing that demonstration through the help of animation. This itself, when the person is able to view certain phenomena, you can actively engage your students in thinking why this is happening, how this is happening, and they are then forced to think and give reasons to you. So here when I go back and see, and you can start this process on the screen, you see dropping two balls near the Earth's surface. Now you can, air resistance is ignored, units are arbitrary, and horizontal speed of the blue ball. So you can go back, show it again, you can change the speed, and you can bring, say, now here you change the speed, now you show them, see, you have changed the speed of one ball. Now the students are able to observe this phenomenon. Now, when you are able to show this phenomena to the students, they are critically involved, critical thinking, they are involved in why this is happening. Once you increase the speed, what is happening to the ball? So you can bring that real life experience in the form of animation to the classroom, and student will be able to pay attention to what is being said. Now, inno hun band karna padega, fir chalega, wapis jana hai to. Kithe ji? Kithe ji? Slides. Bahut bura kita aaj tusi mere naal. ये की कर रहे हो? नेट नहीं चल रहा तो फिर प्रोग्राम ही नहीं रन करना चाहिए ना, फिर की फायदा है फिर जो प्रोग्राम नो रन करने दा? आज ही ज़्यादा प्रॉब्लम आ रही है तोड़े?
हूँ एक चल रहा है, एक नहीं चल रहा है,
हूँ ए चल रहे कि presentations, you bring animations, then you are able to draw the attention of your students to what you are teaching. And one my friend said, if the students are not paying attention in the classroom, then the best strategy to draw the attention of your student is to pose a question, which all of you are doing. I think this is not a novel thing, but many of us pose a question with a specific reference to a particular student. Otherwise, the questioning technique, we throw the question open to the class, wait for the response. But here, if you really want to draw the attention, you pose a question. Then comes that you can use novelty, differences, motion, intensity, you can bring change, brightness, and you can then draw the attention of your students. Likewise, when you are writing on the board, what is more important, you write in bold words, bold letters. You write in capitals, right? Or if you're using a PowerPoint presentation, you are writing it bold, you are changing the color of that. Even while you are writing on the board, you can bring in change in color of the pen, which you are using to highlight some of the important ideas, some of the important concepts which are important to be learned. You sustain attention, you gain attention first, then you sustain attention throughout a period of 15 minutes. The second event of instruction, informing the learner of objectives. Now, when I say objectives, these are the learning outcomes. That means what a student will be able to do at the end of instruction. That is very, very important. So the role of the teacher is that cognitive domain, psychomotor, affective domain objectives. If I am in the classroom, primarily my session is towards attaining some of the cognitive objectives. If I am in the lab, the primary emphasis is on psychomotor domain. And in addition to cognitive and psychomotor, I want to achieve some of the objectives in affective domain. Say, I want my students to be punctual in the class. Now, how do I ensure, as a teacher, when I go to the class, I am punctual myself. I make it clear to the student that a student who is late by 5 minutes or 10 minutes will not be given attendance, but will be allowed to sit in the class. This rule I have framed for myself and my student. My students see that the teacher is always punctual. She's on dot in the class, and you are setting an example before your students. Secondly, I want my student to submit the assignments on time. This is a practical experience that we use negative marking for the students who do not submit their assignments on time. What happens? As assignment of 10 marks, the date is 15th of May. The student who submit the assignment on 15th, he is assessed from 10 marks. A student who submits the assignment on 16th, 1 mark is deducted. The assignment is evaluated from 9 marks. If the student submit on 17th, the evaluation is from 8 marks. Then from 7, and I don't go beyond 7. I say grace of 3 marks. So a student who submits 3 days later, maximum marks the student can attain is 7. He might have done excellent assignment, but because the person is submitting 3 days after the due date, the evaluation is only out of 7. So he can get 100% marks, but a student who has submitted on the 15th, the due date, out of the 10, he may get 7, even if the standard is not that much. So this is how you try to bring change in the attitude, in the behavior component of your students by having a human model in the form of teacher and also framing some rules of attitude and behavior. So when you are trying to start your session, always on the left-hand side of the board, you give a structure that is the content outline of what you are going to deal with. You say, okay, I'm going to teach you communication. So you say, we'll be dealing with the concept of communication, we deal with the process of communication, then we'll deal with principles of effective verbal communication, and principles of effective nonverbal communication. So while you are putting 4 things, you are giving indirectly an information to the learners that they are expected to have the understanding of the concept of communication, the process of communication, and they should have the knowledge of principles of effective verbal and nonverbal communication. Now, this is how you are not directly saying these are the statements of instructional objectives, but you are telling them what they'll be able to do at the end of instruction. The third event of instruction is stimulating recall of prerequisites. So say for example, I'm going and dealing with the concept of communication. Now this is, the student might not have a very technical meaning of the word communication, but every student who is sitting in the class will have layman's idea about the term communication. Likewise, the concept which you teach in your discipline, maybe you are talking of transmission, you are talking about distribution, you are talking about efficiency, you are talking about effectiveness, you are talking about reinforcement, you are talking about programming, you are talking about software. So different disciplines, the terminology. Whenever you start the new terminology, people have some idea of that term. That conception may be right or it may be a misconception. So pose a question. Pose a question, how would you like to explain the term software? how would you like, or what connotation you attach to the word reinforcement? Or what do we understand by the term, say, the transmission a student would give answer, which may be technically correct or incorrect, but you will know what kind of knowledge the student is bringing to the classroom. Another is that whenever you're teaching higher level concept, the subordinate concepts are known to the students. For example, I'm taking the concept of, say, diesel engine and petrol engine. But before I take my student to these types of classification, they already have the concept of engine. So can I ask, what is engine? And if they have rightly understood the concept of engine, then I take them to the two types of engine, diesel and petrol engine. Or maybe if I'm dealing with, say, you can take another example where you are talking about the stresses. So if you are talking with concept they've learned, then you are going to the types. Or if I'm talking about the forces, so I'm dealing with the concept of force and then going to the types of forces which can act upon a beam, then that I pose a question related to the concept and then go further to explaining the different types of forces, right? Likewise, let me take an example, simple example of a triangle. So triangle, the people understand. But if I'm going to now explain the various types of equilateral, right angle and so on, so the previous knowledge is the concept of a triangle. Any figure with a three sides having a angle of 180 degrees.
Equilateral triangle.
Any triangle. Okay. So this is how posing a relevant question would enable the teacher to assess the knowledge which the child or the student brings to the classroom and then relate that knowledge to what you are going to teach. Now, once you bring those concepts which he has already learned in the working memory of the student will be able to relate the previous knowledge to the new information which you are going to provide to him. So learning will become meaningful. Learning will be retained for a longer period of time. You can also give a verbal clue that we have learned this phenomena in the previous class. So you are sending a verbal clue to the student, and then maybe after sending a reminder, you are posing a question again to make sure that they have the right knowledge. You can give a review task. Now, this is a I would like to share whatever you have dealt in the previous class, you bring a small problem related to it. And that you give to the student and they solve that problem before you proceed with the subsequent information. So review tasks which will bring what they have learned in the previous class to their working memory. Or you can give an exercise. I would like to share, I have seen this phenomena happening Indo-Swiss Training Center in Chandigarh. The first 15 minutes of the class, they bring a multiple choice question of 10 to 15 items that is given to the students. They solve that, and that is related to what they have learned in the previous class. So this is how they are trying to bring it to the working memory of the student. So wherever it is needed, not it in the beginning of the class, but say, for example, I'm teaching. Now a concept has come which they have already studied in class 10th or 12th or in the first year or second year of their degree. So I pose a relevant question. I give a relevant task to bring that concept or a rule to their working memory. So once you are able to do that, then students are able to relate new information to what they already know. So meaningful learning would take place. Now, while you are presenting new information to your students, because that is your presenting, okay. while you are presenting new information, that is the major task, and most of your time in the class goes to presenting new information. So what normally we do, we start the session, whatever the technical terminology is coming in that topic, we take it when it appears in the topic. I would say, if you have seen the good books, all the technical terminology is explained in the beginning of that. So if you give, okay, today we will learn 6 new terminologies, you identify what are the new terminologies appearing in that chapter which you are going to deal with, or the topic which is at hand, that terminology must be made clear to the learner beforehand, and then frequently you can use that terminology. So once the meaning is clear, the student has understood the concept, then you can use that terminology without going back to the definition meaning of that terminology. Very rightly, you need to give adequate explanation. Some people bring a definition written on the PowerPoint, they read the definition and they move further. That is not the way a teacher has to deal with the concept. The teacher is giving certain definitions, so that definition learning is also important. But what is more important is that student should be able to explain that concept in his own words and is able to give examples. So what a teacher should do? Teacher should build up adequate explanation with examples. Only then it will be clarified. Now, how I have been doing and dealing with definitions. In social sciences, at least, there can be number of definitions. So what do? I bring a typed sheet which contains 10 to 12 definitions of a concept. I divide the class into small groups. I hand over those sheets to my students. I say, now you go through the 10 definitions. Then you arrive at your own definition of that concept. Now, when there are 6 to 7 groups working in the class, they will come out with their own understanding of those definitions and the commonalities. And then once you reduce it to 6 to 7, then you come out with one comprehensive definition to that concept. Now, once you involve, because repeating definition doesn't clarify the concept if I show all the 10 definitions. So what is, you need to bring change in the way the definitions are taught to the student. So the definitions, the concepts which you are giving, divide the students in groups. Maybe you can use a pyramiding technique. Pyramiding technique is, you first combine 2 students, then you combine 4, then you combine 8, then the whole class, if it is 16, the whole class acts like one unit to come out with the definition. If I discuss the concept with Deepika, then 2 of us join hands with another 2 students, and gradually we reach consensus to one concept. The time required is little more, but the understanding which you infuse among your students is much higher, much higher. Another is, draw attention to distinctive features while dealing with verbal information or learning of concepts. Now, this is important in terms of concepts, as I have taken an example of a chair. So you can think of, while you are dealing with concepts, say you are dealing with the concept of stack and array in computer science. So how stack is different from array, how array is different from stack, or how queue is different from stack, if you are taking these and you are comparing and bringing the distinguishing features of queue and stack, then I think the concept would be much clarified to the students. So when you are dealing with news information, always try to relate it to the context from which to the context to which the students belong. in your classrooms, there may be students from rural area, maybe from urban area. So while you are dealing with, say, transmission, servers talking about, so when you are dealing with transmission, can you take up one example of transmission in a rural area and transmission in an urban area? Can you come out with where the losses are more in rural area or the urban area and the causes? Why it is more in rural area or why in semi-urban area and why not in urban areas? So once you are relating and providing a meaningful context to your students, they relate to that information. And once you relate to that information, the understanding becomes easier and retention is for a longer period of time. Then examples from day-to-day and world of work, because ultimately we expect that our students will be able to apply the learned knowledge. For that, it is expected of us that while we deal with the concepts, the principles, the theories, then we pick up relevant examples from day-to-day life. We pick up examples from the world of work where the knowledge will be applicable. Once we give examples, the student is in a position to generalize. Generalize under what condition this rule will be applicable, under what condition this rule will not be applicable. So you can think of examples, non-examples, to enable the student to generalize where the rule, where the concept, where the theory will be applicable. And you are making your new information more relevant, more interesting to your students. Then there is also technique of chunking. Chunking is club the related information under one head. Now when I say I'm dealing with principles of effective speaking, I try to club all the related information under the heading principle of effective speaking. Then I club the information principle of effective speaking, right? So it is easy for the student to remember principles of effective speaking and the associated information rather than remembering the principle 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, up to 10. That may not be easy for the student. Likewise, that's what, even once we use that, the information, we say Vibgear, it is only that out of the seven colors, you chunk the information under one head called Vibgear. And once a student remembers Vibgear, he remembers the names of the seven colors of the rainbow. Another is, if you're dealing with verbal information, then rehearsing is very important. Rehearsing, maybe oral rehearsing, mental rehearsing. Now see, if I have to remember a telephone number, I repeat that number 10 times or write that number 10 times in my, or there is another individual who is learning by doing, he just give a call twice or thrice to that person dialing the number. Different strategies being used. But if rehearsing, where labels, factual information is to be learned, mental rehearsal is, or rehearsal is needed because rote memorization is required initially. For that purpose, give them the opportunity to write down the information or recall the information orally number of times. So this I have already dealt with. Once you are dealing with principles, the best way to present a principle is to demonstrate. And you have seen that once we are dealing with animations, you can give the demonstration of various principles which are there in the discipline. So you give animated figure where you show the working of that principle. The learning will be more, learning will be retained for a longer period of time. And even when you are dealing with processes or procedure, say how cement is manufactured. Now if I have to show it, I can't demonstrate everything because it will take more time. So I go to the industry, I prepare a video clip of that. The whole process, I show between 20 to 25 minutes because the lag time which is needed can be edited. So integrate media to show processes, to show process procedures, the operation of machineries, equipment, tools, in the work setting, how they are being utilized. So have video clips, show that, and have animation simulation. Another important principle while you are presenting information is use appropriate verbal and non-verbal communication, because there is complete session on that. I'm omitting this, but this is very important component for effective teaching. You may be knowing everything in your discipline, but if you are not able to express, if you are not able to come to the level of the audience, then it will not help you achieving your objective. So pay attention to your communication. We'll be dealing with this tomorrow. And as rightly said in the morning, now we have to think in terms of student-centric methods. Lecture is one. Think of group discussions, seminars, brainstorming, demonstrations, tutorials, and so on, whereby you can actively involve your student in development of lesson. So here, think of variety of methods which are available to you. Try to incorporate new methods of instruction in your delivery, and you will feel the difference the way the students are learning. Then, if the student has to learn, he is actively involved, then he must have the right to clarify the doubts. So always give time to your students to pose questions, to seek clarification, to discuss, to supplement information. And the more interaction and collaboration you would generate within the class, among the students, between the teacher and the student, the higher will be the degree of achievement of objectives. The next is providing learning guidance. So as I said, while initially dealing with this, learning guidance is whereby you can facilitate learning, retention, recall, application of learned knowledge, skills, and attitudes. Some of the strategies which you can use mnemonics, you can use analogies, metaphors, examples, tables, comparisons, examples or illustrations, the diagrams and so on. Here, just I have been using this word WIBGEAR. So easy to remember. So WIBGEAR is mnemonic, which we use. Board masses, another mnemonic. ADDIE is another mnemonic which we use for system design, which goes by analysis, design, development, implementation, and evaluation. So wherever you can coin a word by using the first word of the different terms, it is nothing but a mnemonic. Now here you see my very educated mother just showed us 9 planets. By remembering this, one can remember the 9 planets: Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Saturn, Jupiter, Uranus, Neptune, Pluto. Here, big elephant can always upset small elephant, because types of analogies, just for your reference, just showing you, battery is to flashlight, hard drive is to computer. Fatigue is to yawning, itching is to scratching. Mother is to home, teacher is to school. Poverty is to wealth, sickness is to health. Chicago is Illinois, Denver is Colorado. Pound is to kilogram, quart is to liter. So one can think of, while dealing with various disciplinary knowledge, wherever you can make use of analogies, that will always remain in your mind. Dr. Punia is very good in creating analogies. Whenever he's dealing with, he's so quick in relating it to the real life. So you remember those things very easily. Similes, as tall as giraffe, as beautiful as rose. So think of similes as soft as a cloud, as sly as a fox, as silly as a clown, as fat as a pig, as tasty as KFC and so on. So you can coin similes wherever you can use. Now when you use these similes, analogies, things are easier for the students to learn. Likewise, metaphors. There is a difference. Metaphor is you are building a relationship between two things which are, have no connection to each other. Now when you talk in terms of badal ki tarah awara fira, pet mein chuhe kood rahe hain, butterflies are there in my stomach. These are nothing but metaphors. Muscles are strong as steel. So here, if you can, now here you can see heart and literal pattern is blood from veins pumps through the superior vena cava into. Pump moves liquid through a system to make an exchange. Unanoni nazar aa rahe. Okay. Refrigerant is pumped through a coil, heat pump and so on. So you are trying to establish relationship between a heat pump and a heart where there is no relationship at all. Groups, now everybody knows that we have been trying to remember these things, periodic table, so easy to remember, easy to have visual imagery and then remember. So there, these are scientific principles based upon the scientific principles, these are based upon scientific principles of learning. So you as a teacher is not only presenting, transferring, sharing information, but you are enabling the student to remember that information, recall that information, apply that information. So in addition to that, when you are proceeding with the topic, you are trying to elicit performance to make sure that whatever you are teaching is being understood by the student. So what the techniques you might have been using, I'm not going to go, because all of us make use of these techniques. We either pose a question, maybe at the sub component we have dealt with, we have a rapid fire question round, we give multiple choice question, we give a problem to the student to solve, make sure that he has understood the formula, or if the person has to derive the relationship, we ask him to do the derivation and so on. So all these activities are essential to assure yourself of the understanding on the part of the student. So make sure that you don't only talk. You give time to your students. You give time, you involve them and give them practice, so that you are sure they have rightly understood. Then very important, once you have given the task, then you provide knowledge of result to your student. Tell them whether they are right or wrong. You are not grading, you are not assessing, but you are giving them whether they are right or wrong. And this knowledge of result should be task related. You should not make any generalized comments, but only provide task-related feedback to the student. Yes, this is this part of the numerical or answer is correct. This part of the numerical is wrong. I cannot say you are not worth. You cannot achieve anything in life. I cannot make such comments. You have to be very, very objective. I don't give feedback looking to the face of the child. It is objective. It is not subjective. If I like a student, usko achhe se feedback de deti hu. Nahi achha lagta, usko achhe se punish, criticize kar deti hu. Aisa nahi. I have to be very objective and task-related information I give to the student. It has to be specific. If it is right, which part of it is right, which part of it is wrong? It has to be corrective. I must tell him how to correct the incorrect response, how to arrive at the correct solution to the problem. And the feedback has to be immediate. It cannot be delayed. Delayed feedback is no feedback. अगर मैं क्लास से चली गई, हफ्ते बाद याद आ गया बच्चे ने बहुत अच्छा आंसर दिया था, और मैं बच्चे को बोल रही हूँ 7 दिन पहले ना क्लास में उस दिन आपने बहुत अच्छा, now he doesn't remember the question, he doesn't remember the answer, so your feedback loses the value. So immediately give the feedback to the student. Assessing performance. अब जब उसको आ गया, once you are sure that student have understood, then only you assess the performance of the learner. Grading जो भी करनी है ना, जब आ जाए, normally what are the procedures which we adopt? बच्चे को आता ही नहीं है, हम उसको सवाल पूछते हैं, उसको grade कर देते हैं. पहले सिखाओ तो सही. So give assignment which may be used for grading purposes. Give a small minor project which is one day project. अब देखिए, maybe आपने कहा कि प्रोजेक्ट देखिए, आपने वायर्स पे दे सकते हैं, गियर्स पे दे सकते हैं, सॉफ्टवेयर्स अवेलेबल इन द मार्केट, काइंड ऑफ टिम्बर अवेलेबल इन द मार्केट, उसका एक चार्ट बना के लाएं, प्राइसेस लिख के लाएं, वैरायटीज लिख के लाएं, एंड सो ऑन. एंड सच स्मॉल माइनर प्रोजेक्ट विच कंज्यूम्स अबाउट 2 to 3 hours इन द मार्केट, एंड दे हैव टू कैरी आउट अ स्मॉल सर्वे एंड ब्रिंग अ रिपोर्ट. ऐसे प्रोजेक्ट्स आप अपने माइनर प्रोजेक्ट्स ले सकते हैं, विच कैन बी असाइन टू स्टूडेंट ऑन एंड ऑफ, वीक में एक बार, दो वीक में एक बार दे सकते हो. एंड सेमिनार्स, यू कैन हैव गिवन अ टॉपिक, यू हैव टॉट दैट टॉपिक, नाउ यू आस्क द स्टूडेंट टू मेक अ, डोंट डू दैट, यू डोंट टीच एंड आस्क द स्टूडेंट टू मेक अ प्रेजेंटेशन. नो, आई एम ऑफ अ डिफरेंट व्यू, यू हैव डेल्ट विद द टॉपिक, नाउ after maybe 15 days, 20 days, you are asking students, whatever topics you have covered during the previous days, you have made groups in the class. Now, those groups are making a seminar presentation in the class. Now, how it helps? Ek to revision hai, ek unki independent learning hai, they'll be referring to various sources, they have the clarification of concept from the teacher. So, this will continue. वो नहीं है, नहीं चल रहा, कोई गल तो इन्हें चलन दे, कितने गया मेरे तो कर देना है, किन्ने कुछ करता. सो यू कैन यूज सेमिनार एज अ स्ट्रेटजी फॉर ग्रेडिंग पर्पसेस. यू कैन ऑल्सो यूज अ फॉर्मल टेस्ट फॉर ग्रेडिंग स्टूडेंट्स ऑन द लर्निंग. सो फॉर्मल सबमिटिव असेसमेंट ऑफ द स्टूडेंट कैन बी ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ असाइनमेंट, प्रोजेक्ट, सेमिनार, टेस्ट, राइट. Then the last activity which you have to promote is enhancing retention and transfer. Missing it. Enhancing retention and transfer, that simply means that the more examples from varied settings you give, the more applications you quote in the class where this particular concept, rule, principle is applicable in the world of work, the greater will be the generalizability on the part of the student and the transference of learning will be more. Another strategy is give them problems from the real life, from the world of work, where they need to apply the learned knowledge. So transfer of learning would be facilitated. For revision, I would say, seminar is one strategy where these students are helping you out in reviewing the information which they have learned, and they recall that information and there is revision of that information. Another is, in a month you keep one class where students can clarify their doubts related to whatever you have taught in the previous days. So that itself will help the students to recall the information, review the information and relearn the information. So that can help. Now here the last slide which I'm showing is that these 9 events of instruction have direct correlation to the process of learning. The learning process starts with attention, and if there is expectancy aroused that they will learn something worthwhile, They can do some tasks which they are unable to do. There is some future worth of what they are going to learn. That is you, that expectancy is aroused. Then the student is motivated to learn. Then the person tries to recall the relevant concept to his working memory. And you see on the other side that you as a teacher stimulate the recall of the prerequisites. Then the process of perception is selective. So while you are presenting information, you are also highlighting what is important in that. You are using all those techniques of gaining and sustaining attention. And once you are elaborating, giving examples, the student is able to give meaning or assign meaning to those elements of your lecture which are highlighted, which are said to be important, which are brought to the foreground in the lecture. So selective perception principle is used while you are presenting stimulus material, and you are facilitating the learner to derive or attach meaning to incoming information. Then by providing learning guidance, you are enabling the student to encode the incoming information and take that incoming information to his long-term memory. Because immediately it goes to short-term memory. Then from short-term memory, by meaningfully relating it to what you already know, by giving a new meaning, according you construct meaning of the new information, or you relate it to the concepts already known, the principles already known, you transfer that information from short memory to long-term memory. Even your maintenance rehearsal, where you are remembering information orally or written form, you are taking information from short to long-term memory. Then the next one is eliciting performance and providing feedback. That is, you make the student respond to certain questions, problems, tasks, exercises, and then you are reinforcing the right behavior. Once you are providing feedback, at the same time you are using the principle of reinforcement, telling the person that you have done well. This part is done excellently, but this part requires a little improvement, and you are providing a corrective feedback. You are giving feedback, you are reinforcing the right part, you are providing corrective. Then the person has learned the material. Then you go for assessing the performance. And the last one is you are enhancing retention and transfer. So queuing, retrieval, that once a person is able to recall the learned information, apply in a given situation, that is the learning process in totality. So if as a teacher you are trying to integrate all these 9 events into your direct instruction, your instruction will be effective and you will be able to achieve your objective. So friends, this is all about the events of instruction. If you have any question, then you are welcome. Yes, friends at the network centers, if you have any question right now, maybe I'll be able to answer, or if you suggest, we can have question answer session after the management skills video. Yes, anybody would like to pose a question? Any clarification? Ji.
Hello, ma'am.
Anji.
Anurag, ma'am, this side from IMS.
Anji, please go on.
Ma'am, what happens actually nowadays, we are having students in the class from different walks of the life, right? They are having different backgrounds.
Yes.
They are having different family backgrounds. So what happens actually, 30 to 40% students are pretty much interested in teaching or in the learning, while some 2-3% are some mischievous kind of. So what they do, they try to increase their set while from first year to fourth year. So in the beginning, in the first year when this was the 4%, in the fourth year this was around 40% of the class. So how to go with these kind of students?
Now, thank you very much for raising this question. The heterogeneity in the classroom is on increase. And as you have rightly said, that maybe there are 30 to 40% of the students who are really interested in learning, but the remaining are not that much interested, and there are 3 to 4% who are mischievous in class. Now, I'll share one of the examples which I have used in my classroom when I was teaching in a school. I started my career from a school, and I had very notorious students in 7th class, a group of 5 students who were creating all kind of mischiefs in the class. One strategy is, why these students create mischiefs? Because maybe there is a lack of attention to them. What you can do is, be friendly to them, be approachable, be accessible to those 5, become more friendly to this group of students who are creating mischiefs in the class. One, if you establish a rapport with these students, half of your problems are gone. Because the problems they create, they'll no longer be there in your classroom. Another strategy is, you have to use variety of techniques. Because the students who are unable to pay attention to, maybe they want that there is activity-based learning. Learning by doing always involve the learner. So you have to think of, how do I gainfully engage my students? That you group them, one very good student, one average student, one poor student. So maybe the category, the grouping is in this manner, whereby they get an opportunity to learn from each other. Peer learning opportunities need to be generated in the class. Why should I take the responsibility of teaching everything in a one similar fashion to all the students are very different? So can I evolve a system whereby I do grouping? One time I've done 1, 2, 3, 4, they make one group. Another time I have arranged 2, 3, 4, 5. So every student gets an opportunity to work with other students who are available in the class. The third strategy which you can use is, always while you are giving a lecture, always try to supplement whatever you are saying verbally through diagrams, illustrations, animations, simulation. Because your students, they have different learning styles also. It is not that 3-4% who are making noises, who are mischievous, they'll not be interested in the either learning by doing or the media. So you have to devise a mechanism whereby you integrate various technologies or various methods of instruction to involve them. Another, if you know the management principle, then those who are mischievous can be given higher responsibility. Now you have given an assignment. You pick up one of the students who is very mischievous and assign him the responsibility to make sure that the assignments are completed and returned on time. So he is made the leader of those activities, whereby he owns the power, he feels that he has been empowered, and he owns the responsibility of getting the work done. So this is one of the management techniques whereby the notorious people, they are made group leaders or the leaders of such tasks. Another technique which you can use is, identify the strengths of people, the students in the class. One person may be very good in writing. Another person may be very good in doing work on machines and psychomotor skill mein bahut acha. Another person may be very good in interpersonal skills. So when you are trying to assign activities, tasks to your students, always to assign responsibility based upon their strengths. Unki strengths ko limelight mein laiye. So, jab aap unki strengths ko limelight mein laayo, they are gainfully used, tab wo empowered feel karenge. Tab unki jo problems hai, wo kam hoti chali jayenge. So, use ye, because this kind of is always situational. What works in my situation may not work in your situation. So you have to be very sure who is the person, what kind of person is that, and what technique will is more applicable on that individual. But there are a number of strategies. So try to understand, try to generate alternate solution, then try to experiment with different solutions in your classroom situation. That will help. Ji, any other question? So, Hanji, if there are no other questions, so friends, we break for lunch. We reassemble. What is the time right now? 1:30 is the time. I'll request that all of you be back 2:15. Is it agreeable? Is it agreeable to all? Can I get yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, so we reassemble at 2:15. We have a video clip on management skills by Dr. M.P. Punia, which will be followed by a question answer session, and I'll request sir to join us at around 3:30 for taking up your questions. So thank you very much for participating in the session.